There's a lot of chat at the moment about how central banks around the world will begin to shift away from pumping unprecedented amounts of liquidity into the markets. Do they raise rates or taper QE, or a mix of both? It is also one thing a central bank making monetary decisions for an economy over which it has complete control. But how will the European Central Bank and, or more importantly, Brussels respond to the economic data chasm that appears to be opening up between the likes of Germany, which needs tighter monetary conditions, and the southern states that need the ECB's easy money policy? Welcome to this week's ID Trading the Markets podcast. I'm Jeremy Naylor. I'm talking today to Mark Ostwald, Chief Economist and Global Strategist at ADM ISI. Mark, welcome. Before we get on to the ECB, on a general note and with your global hat on, is it time to discuss the shift into tighter monetary policy? Do you think the debate is really hot, I know, around the Fed at the moment?
Yeah, I mean, I think there's two different issues here. There is a question around how much, what exactly all the QE is actually achieving. Is it really achieving more asset bubbles and asset price inflation rather than boosting economies? That's an eternal debate that we've had since the global financial crisis, and that will continue to rage on. The second one relates to, are we at a stage where we are, with the vaccination rollout, getting to the point where the support from central banks and indeed the fiscal support, but let's just stick with central banks for the moment, should be withdrawn. And a lot of that is premised on, above all, on the rise that we've seen in commodity prices. I think the jury on that side of the equation is very much out. The problematics that central banks have got is twofold. One, it's getting that timing right, whereby probably being reactive, as they've all promised to be, rather than proactive, which well, at most the Bank of Canada appears to be being. Being reactive is probably sensible. However, this whole issue around how transitory is the inflation, it's a very difficult one. Because I think really where the big challenge lies is in making estimations of how much of these problems are supply disruptions because of the pandemic, how much of it is above all due to hoarding because of the experience of the pandemic. And there's certainly lots of evidence of that around the world, be that China or the US, and indeed in Europe. And how much of it is due to the fact that actually the transports and logistics sector, which is the sector which needs to basically step up, so to speak, to ease some of these problems, is not willing to do it. It simply isn't willing to do it because it looks at this as being likely to be very transitory and saying, well, what do we do with all the bulking up of capacity that we do afterwards? And on that hangs a lot of how much of these price pressures that we're seeing, how much of them will actually stick. Though I would add in that respect, there is, you know, if we're looking at the inflation data at the moment, whether it's in the United States, whether it's in Europe, even in China, we're not actually for the time being, and the jury is very much out on this, really seeing a lot of pressures other than things which are related to one-offs to do with reopening.
Staying with the monetary side of things, I want to get onto the fiscal side in just a minute, but there are forecasts that German inflation will break 3% this year, something that Europe had ruled out in the Maastricht Treaty. It wanted to avoid that sort of situation coming about. Germany needs higher rates, but will it win the argument if it takes the request to the European Central Bank, do you think?
I doubt it. At the moment, as it's been the case for a very long time, the doves have the majority. It's not a huge majority, but they have the majority. The problematic is that in this situation where you are making promises and you've got markets basically believing in the central bank backstop for asset prices, the very mention of a withdrawal of some of the liquidity, let alone raising rates. And I think, you know, this is definitely a case of withdrawing the liquidity is the first step. Talking about raising rates is something completely different. It is probably a good deal further out. But the moment you actually get to that, then you have a market management problem. We know markets are not actually very liquid. All the central bank liquidity doesn't actually make for a lot of market depth. And that's partly due to the fact of the regulations enacted post-GFC. banks basically just won't make markets the way they used to. So we continue to see, and we still see it now, even with all the money pumping that's going on, these bouts of volatility, even if they're short-lived, which are, to put it mildly, quite violent.
Where does that leave the ECB then? I mean, it is clearly having to face this difficult conundrum, isn't it, where there is this chasm that appears to be opening up between the data we're getting from Germany. I mean, we had some German GDP out today as of the time of recording. I know it's a touch weaker than had been expected, but nonetheless, the ECB is to be focused on prices. And with this problem that Germany seems to have, it does need a very different sort of monetary policy than the European Central Bank is able to provide. How do you see the ECB going about trying to address this issue?
Well, it's going to be down to Madame Lagarde's political abilities, and this is in bridging the gap between North and South. I'm not so sure, actually, Germany has really quite the inflation problem that people are talking about. A lot of it is base effects. You know, the big jump that we saw in January was all basically due to the ending of the VAT reduction. At the moment, that's where it's at. And, you know, we'll have further base effects as we go through, particularly the next 3 or 4 months. But what's durable, and above all, what we're seeing in terms of core inflation at the moment, core inflation is showing little signs of picking up. Obviously, there's a big caveat here. We don't really know how much of a spillover there's going to be into key elements of core inflation, which are related to the recreation and leisure sectors, which are only literally now just starting to open up. How much pressure are we going to see there? Because that's really going to be the critical aspect. And in that respect, Madame Lagarde can wait. But the bigger problem is, if they keep up with the current pace, which isn't really markedly faster than before of QE purchases, and to be honest, which markets aren't actually overly impressed by. When they said they would pick up pace, markets were thinking of something far more aggressive than has actually come to pass. But in a certain sense, that's a good thing, because it basically means that if they say, well, we don't need to go at quite the same pace, then they can reduce at a slower pace. But it is going to create a problem, and it's above all going to create a problem, because what's really been driving yield spreads tighter, though we have seen some widening of late as things start to pick up and we start to reopen these economies, has been the ECB purchases. The moment you get to the point where the ECB says we're not going to be as aggressive, then you are going to see a marked widening, particularly in countries like Spain and Greece, and to a certain extent, Portugal and Spain. And as we know, there are huge structural problems which were there long before the pandemic, but have exacerbated those, and the spending needs to come through. And at the same time, we are still dithering on this whole issue of when is this recovery program going to actually be ratified by all the 27 governments, with Finland at the moment proving particularly problematic.
Okay, let me just break that down a little bit, because there's quite a lot of the sort of mechanics going on there that you're talking about. Look, the situation is, I understand at the moment, is the ECB has a current rate of, I think, around about, what is it, 80 billion euros in net purchases a month, I think. Now, there's some talk, as we know, about tapering. If the ECB does taper, it does start to talk about that, it has an opportunity as a window on the June the 10th when the next meeting happens. But if it does start to do that, and this is where you're going to have to correct me if I'm wrong, but my understanding of the whole system, the setup, is that it does start to begin to taper. It potentially pushes up funding costs, doesn't it? And the weaker economies where there are massive debts, which you alluded to, such as Greece and Italy, the southern economies, there's going to be a massive destabilization, isn't there, if they do start to begin this move into a tapering process?
There is going to be a destabilization. I think we need to be a little bit careful about the level of destabilization. I think what people always forget with bond yields is they look at it and say, well, that's going to increase costs of borrowing for X, Y, or Z country. Actually, it really depends what's rolling off. And for the time being, actually, we've still got a lot of debt, which is going to be, even if, say, yields rose by 50 basis points, you're still probably going to be rolling off debt which has higher coupons. So actually, in government cost terms, it's not that problem. And I think the more important issue here, it's not really about debt costs. It's about the actual burden of debt. So it's the principal rather than the principal debt, i.e. huge volumes. And we know, you know, Italy's budget deficit is spectacular, and its outstanding government debt, you know, at 155 roughly percent of GDP is enormous. Greece is even worse than that. That's where the challenges lie. It's the perception that they will basically come under further pressure, and literally every penny that they have to use for debt servicing costs rather than for investment in the economy and boosting the economy and supporting the economy is basically going to be a problem. So, you know, that is the issue. And it then becomes an issue of what do markets do in any case? Do we have a basically a rush away from risk assets, which case you're actually going to see, you know, Madame Lagarde likes to talk about financing conditions, and this is going to be the issue. It's not just for the governments, but it's also at the corporate level. Just when you're coming out of recovery and you want actually companies to borrow more and boost the economy by boosting investments as things become somewhat clearer, you actually see a fundamental rise in funding costs. And a lot of them have already accumulated a lot of debt in any case. So the last thing that they need is the additional burden of extra funding costs. So it is hugely challenging. I don't think there's actually any solution which is an easy solution, but it is probably important to recognize that actually the ECB withdrawing stimulus is less important if it's done gradually than a premature withdrawal of fiscal support, because a lot of countries basically at the moment are supporting their labor markets. The last thing they need to see is when some of the unemployment or the employment protection programs start to be withdrawn, which probably be a lot later in Europe than it will be, say, in the UK or the US.
Let's pick up on that point about moving on to the fiscal side of things now. What's going through the minds of the bureaucrats in Brussels at the moment? Because I know that there are some, in fact, probably more than some, if that is a number, that want to have a unified tax system across Europe. Now, there are a lot of hurdles to pass before they even get to that stage, if indeed they ever get there. Because that, I think, my understanding is that would solve all sorts of problems. That Europe could then lie happy in bed at night, thinking that these issues that we've currently got are no longer going to exist. So the bureaucrats in Brussels are sort of obviously chewing over the options here, knowing that some of the options may not be available to them. How do you see Brussels moving on this?
Well, Brussels' biggest challenge actually at the moment is the challenge that anyone looking at the Eurozone is going to be taking into account is no one really knows what the outcome of the German elections are going to be in September. And there's the additional uncertainty of the French elections next year, the presidential elections. So they are definitely concerned. You know, I think the idea of a unified system, fundamentally, Germany is still opposed to it. That's certainly the political narrative. It would be less opposed to it if we got some sort of traffic light coalition, a Jamaica coalition, which would basically include the Conservatives and the Liberals and the Greens. It would be probably less resistant. But as long as you have a CDU-CSU involved in this, something which is more permanent in terms of a unified system, it's still a pipe dream. You would have thought that the lessons from the pandemic is clearly that is exactly what is needed. But I don't think the political will is there. And if you've got a difficult construction of a new German government coming up, let alone the idea that, say, Marine Le Pen won the French elections next year, it becomes even more difficult because you're going to have a lot of nationalism on display. So the Brussels bureaucrats certainly are sort of looking at the situation and thinking, how do we get to a situation? And this is what the importance of the ratification of the recovery program is, because if that fails, then anything else you can kiss goodbye to.
Okay, let me just pick up on that point as well, because kissing goodbye to what? The current structure as it is? I mean, because some people are writing about this in terms of the potential for the whole setup of the Eurozone here, unless this is resolved. And some are saying that if the COVID recovery, if you like, is so lumpy, it's so differentiated between economies within the Eurozone, it will be far too big a problem for the ECB to be able to manage under the current strictures. Do you see the Eurozone falling apart over this, or do you see another fudge coming?
I always opt for the fudge, but it's not necessarily a good fudge in the sense that if we stay within the current structure, what you're looking at is a Eurozone which might see a little bit more inflation, but I very much doubt it. You only have to look at market inflation expectations. No one expects the ECB to hit its target in the next 5 years. That says a lot. That basically is the market saying they don't really believe there's going to be the political will there to develop a sort of growth dynamic, which would require a much more unified fiscal system, above all in terms of transfer payments, to ensure that the North, which can afford to support the South more, makes those transfer payments. So, you know, that really is the big challenge. I still think there will be a will to carry on fudging this, because at the end of the day, no one benefits by the whole thing falling apart.
Just one final question, if we can, and that is taking a look at where we go from here. Let's assume that we get sympathetic governments coming in France and Germany over the next 18 months. Let's assume that the pandemic continues to recover. Let's hope that's the case, because we all need it. And let's assume that in a year, 18 months, 2 years' time, you know, things are resolved or beginning to get resolved. Where do you see the euro? Where do you see the eurozone? What do you see happening over the next 18, 20 months in terms of the European Union and where it goes?
Well, if we get what I would call constructive governments in both Germany and France, then I think there is the lessons from the pandemic will be that they need to work much more closely together. There's no doubt about it. But we really need the whole management at a national and a Eurozone level of the recovery path, because as we start to roll back some of the support systems and we then try to give growth a boost, and a lot of that's going to come through the green recovery, and that's going to be, you know, that's going to be contentious, because, you know, it's all very well talking about a green recovery and all these ideals, but at the end of the day, someone's got to pay for it. And this is really where the big arguments are going to come. And this is where my biggest concern would be, that even if we have a positive backdrop in terms of governments wanting to work for each other, the actual issue of who's actually going to pay for it is huge.
Mm. That's a podcast for another day, I think, Mark. Thanks for the idea. Yep. Look, Mark, we've got to leave it there. But thank you so much indeed for joining us. It's a pleasure getting your thoughts on the European Central Bank.
Thank you.
That's Mark Oswald. He's Chief Economist and Global Strategist at ADM ISI. For more videos like these, follow us on Twitter and Instagram, and subscribe to our YouTube channel.